by saying that what I do is not for everyone. It's a different lifestyle. If you don't have hopes or aspirations of sending your children at all, ever incurring expenses in dollars or pounds, or then by all means, it's not for you. You know, this is great. There are tons of opportunities in Nigeria, and we can play at that level. That's what I said. So that's what I started with. But even having said that, and Koji referenced that you have to create a product that benefits people. I created my experiences, all my products, and what I preach is born from personal experience, every single one of it. I gave an experience about my father, who was stuck in a foreign nation, who couldn't send money for his treatment, you know. That obviously changed my attitude towards investment. So they were all born from personal experiences. Why did I decide that I wanted to specialize in offshore investments? Very simple. We decided to invest in the real estate on the island. And so we took in a lot of money from outside the country and we brought it in here. And as soon as we brought it in here, the dollar notes died. And that investment is still underwater. Even as we speak, 2 years on, it's still under, or 3 years on, it's still underwater. So that made me think that if I went through this, a lot of people went through this as well. And I realized a lot of people withdrew their kids from England and America when the dollar was, AYR. And the economy is still, we're still coming out of recession, you know. We're not out there yet. I know they said there's a growth, but if you compare the growth with the population growth, we're not there yet. You know, so that made me create a product that I still believe that it doesn't make sense for me to want to send my children to America to study and I'm investing in Nigeria. So when they need the money, then the money is worthless. What am I doing? So I need to go to that country to find out what I can invest in that will be useful for me in 5, 10, 15 years, short, long, or medium term, or for my medical bills. You know, I can't want to fly for maybe a cataract operation in, I don't know, Dubai, and I'm trying to gather a booking, trying to negotiate what the offering is at the moment. I can't do that. So this is, like I said, it's personal experience. So I knew I had to go to America and find investment. And yet, yes, the real estate guru here rightly said, when investments are underwater, they're underwater. Every single country has suffered a major economic depression. Whether real estate, stocks, whatever, they go down under, you know. But this, here's the thing. Every time there's a recession, it's like war. After war, what happens? There's tons of opportunities to make money. Tons of opportunities to make money. And that's exactly where I identified. The properties that I'm investing in, I'm buying some of them for a quarter or less than that of the price. And I know they'll still go up. That's why going back to work up now. So as long as you can do your comms, your statistics, your research to identify those key assets and identify them in multiple classes, then you're fine. And you know, the gentleman said, if I had 100,000 naira, what would I do with it? Trust me, I'll spend 90,000 naira educating myself. There is nothing like financial education. And financial education is one. People talk about personal finance, save, invest, and so on. But I'm specific about investment education. That's what you need to spend most of your money in. By the time you buy Robert Kiyosaki's books and Trump's books, 90,000, 10,000 naira, open a dummy account and trade, and start learning how to trade. But 90% I would spend on education. And here's the reason why. When I was practicing English law after I finished university, I made tons of money. But I spent tons of money. Buy bags, buy shoes, sunglasses, money's gone. So it's irrelevant sometimes how much you have. If you don't know where to channel those monies to, you're still gonna be back to square one. And I look back, I think, oh my God, if I had those monies that I had then, man, gosh, I'll be lounging in the Bahamas somewhere. So it's not really the money you start with that is relevant, it's the education. And that's how I started my business. I booked a one-way ticket. I booked a return ticket to Atlanta. I didn't even buy the ticket, I used mileage because I didn't have the ticket money in my account. And I went there for 1 week, strategic meeting with key partners. And then when I identified the need, that the potential of this market, and the one in London, I came back and I set up a business. And was it tough? Oh, absolutely, it was tough in the beginning. Trying to convince people, because you're trying to tell them, oh, you have the credibility to invest in the foreign market for them, you have the credibility to invest in the foreign estate for them, you can package estate planning trusts instead of trusting Cayman Islands or Azerbaijan, whatever they want, you know. It was tough. But like when we talk about passion, I churn that passion out into profit. And I think when people see me and have a one-on-one to them and they hear me talk about investment, they know that this is not something that, you know, this is in our DNA. Experience plus passion. And of course, little by little, before I knew what, I was setting up companies, three companies in three different countries, you know, and all of this in the matter of months. So I didn't start like this. Yes, I started very, had nothing, you know, when I decided to set up Money Stewards. It was just, okay, let me see what I can do. And before I knew it, I had to even close the funds. I said, you know what, I'm sorry, I'm not taking funds for now because I need to invest in the ones I have. So, 100,000.
Are you back to thinking? Are you back to thinking now?
You're both speaking the truth. But the investor has to determine what he wants and what he is investing
for. Or what she wants.
Yes, what he or she wants and what she or he is investing for. You know, that is very, very important. If you want a diversified portfolio, by all means, invest for that. If you want local and international investments, please, by all means, go for it. But what is most important is that you invest for alignment. Let it align with your core values, your philosophy, your beliefs, and knowledge. Very, very important. And let there be a purpose for your investment. Don't just invest for investment's sake. There must be a reason, there must be a purpose. There's some people that invest for short term, there's some people that invest for medium term, and there's some people that invest for long term. If you put if you want to invest for short term and you go and invest in instruments that are long term instruments, you cannot dispose of them in short term. So I think that's what one of the things Motunraya is alluding to, that make sure that you have all the information and you acquire all the knowledge and you do your research before you get into it. But I want to speak to the entertainment industry. You know, you talked about the industry having moved from where it was to where it is now. It's not just entertainment. Everything evolves. And if you're not innovative and creative, you will die. In anything that you do. So, let us take the situation that you've given as an example. Ebony Live TV, right? And let's take Wedding Party, for example. Right? So, everybody is hearing is Ebony Live TV, but was Ebony Live TV in collaboration with other people in the industry? So it was a collective effort and competencies were identified, skills were identified, resources were identified, goals were set. Some had assets, some had the distribution networks, and so we looked at the entire value chain. And then it was a collaboration. So the person that was strong with branding and marketing was brought in. The person that had the TV platform for PR, marketing, and promo was brought in. You know, the person that had the industry information in terms of what the market needed at that point in time, what kind of film the market needed, humor, story, you know, what kind of stars were reigning, right? And they didn't really break the bank. If you look at it in terms of each person's contribution, they didn't really break the bank, which speaks to the point that he was making. There are also collectives for investments too. So don't try and be the big fish in a small pond. You can be, you know, a small fish in collaboration with other small fish in an ocean. So, you know, it is the era of content, but your content has to be meeting a need. There must be demand for your content. So you don't have a product until you know who needs it, what they need, what their need is, And then you go and create your product. Don't create a product and try and feed it to the market. It will not sell. Gone are those days. So you must do your research and find out what the market really, really needs. And then you choose your actors properly, you write your script properly, and then, you know, you determine, that determines what happens to you. Now also, identify what level of the market you want to play in. You don't have to play up market. There are different levels of the market, even in the film industry, that you can play in. And there are different places that you can create content and sell your content to. So, if you're a content maker, this is your time. However, it's not just about thinking or creating content. You have to do your homework. You have to do a lot of research. You have to, just like you are doing any, look, movie production or creating content is like you are doing any other business. If you do not follow the fundamentals, you will fail.
Thank you. Thank you so much.